Hello and welcome. My name is Pei Wen Ren. I am a visiting student in Professor Wen Hao-sun's group at University of Michigan. And today I'm going to show you how to derive the JMAK equation using the time cone method. So you may be wondering, what is the JMAK equation and what is the time cone method? Well, to give you some background, the physical picture I want you to have in mind is that suppose we have a box. And within this box, we have a liquid phase transforming into a solid phase. And the question we're asking here is that with concurrent nucleation and growth, what is the volume fraction of this box that has been transformed into the solid phase? So let's roll back this animation and rewatch the phase transformation taking place. But this time, let's also plot the phase fraction transformed versus time on a separate figure. And we can see that as the phase transformation is taking place, the curve we get has a sigmoid-like shape. So the equation governing this process, or namely the equation used to plot this figure, is called the JMAK equation. And it states that the phase fraction transformed is equal to 1 minus e to the power of minus pi over 3 times j times r dot cube times t to the power of 4, with j being the nucleation rate and r dot being the growth rate. And this JMAK equation is what we want to derive with the time cone method at the end of this video. Some of you may say, so if we know the nucleation and growth rates, the JMAK equation can tell us at any given time t, the phase fraction by volume that has been transformed. Okay, this is all well and good. We can see how this can make a good exam question. But how do we use it in real-world applications? So imagine you are a computational material scientist, and you have predicted many new compounds with some amazing properties. To confirm your predictions, you have to synthesize them in a lab or ask your experimentalist friend to make them for you. Ideally, you're going to use your domain knowledge as filters to select the compounds that may be synthesizable in theory. And once you start thinking about how to make them, there are many variables that need to be considered. For example, do you add heat treatment? Do you grind the precursors? Do you put them in a solution? Do you add pressure? So there are many factors at play here. And this leads us to a very big problem, which is oftentimes we know what to make, or namely the chemical formulas and atomic structures of these new compounds, predicted with either first principle calculations or data-driven methods, but how to make them is actually a very difficult problem. For the sake of today's topic, let's focus on one aspect in predictive synthesis, which is how do we know, before doing experiments, the optimal thermal processing pathway to transition from the precursor phase to a target phase. If you have taken any introductory level material science classes, you may remember that there is a diagram that tells us that processing pathway, and it is called the time temperature transformation diagram, or TTT diagram for short. So looking at this TTT diagram, we're essentially plotting temperature on the y-axis and time on the x-axis. And let's label this precursor phase on the left as phase A, and the target phase on the right as phase B. The optimal processing pathway here means that we want phase A to transition into phase B as fast as possible. And to do that, we need to start at T6 and very rapidly cool down to T4 and maintain that temperature so that we can go from phase A to phase B in the shortest amount of time possible. And we can actually generate this TTT diagram computationally by plotting the phase fraction transformation curves governed by the JMAK equation at different temperatures. So to better illustrate how we can get the TTT diagram from the JMAK equation, let's take a look at a single phase transformation curve at a very low temperature and see what happens when we increase the temperature. Here at the top, we have the JMAK equation plotted for a given combination of the nucleation and growth rates. At this low temperature, we have large undercooling and therefore a large driving force for nucleation, which means that we have large nucleation rate. As for the growth rate, because of the low temperature, the atoms are moving around with a very low speed, so the growth rate is slow. At the bottom, we have the TTT diagram sharing the same time axis with the JMAK equation plot. So from the JMAK equation, let's mark the time it takes to reach 10% transformed, 50% transformed, and 99% transformed, and put down those time values for the current temperature on the TTT diagram. Then let's increase the temperature and trace the path of these three time values as the temperature goes upward. And as we can see, the nucleation rate starts to decrease due to the decreasing driving force as the temperature increases, while the growth rate starts to increase as a result of faster atomic motion with increasing temperature. It is this interaction between decreasing nucleation rate and increasing growth rates that gives rise to the characteristic nose cone shape of this TTT diagram. So now we know how we can get a TTT diagram from the JMAK equation, we need to talk about how we can derive the JMAK equation itself. As mentioned earlier, we're going to use the time cone method to do that. So the logical order of thinking should be, we start from the time cone method to get the JMAK equation, and by plotting the JMAK equation at different temperatures, we can get the TTT diagram, which tells us the optimal thermal processing pathway from the precursor phase to a target phase. So let's dive into the time cone method itself. The time cone method was originally developed by the late Professor John Cahn in his paper titled The Time Cone Method for Nucleation and Growth Kinetics on a Finite Domain. If you want to read it for yourself, I will put a link to the original paper in the description below. To talk about the time cone method, we first need to ask what is a time cone. So let's say we have a nucleus and it is growing in one dimension. In other words, it can only grow on a line. We assume that its growth rate is constant with time and is also isotropic, meaning that its growth rate is the same in all directions. And this animation is only one way to show this nucleation and growth process. And what we're doing here is essentially playing out this process with time, meaning that as time passes, we're overlaying the region that this line has grown to on top of what it was before. So another way to show this process is plotting time as an actual axis, in addition to the one spatial axis we already have here. I know this may sound confusing, so let's see what that actually looks like. Here, the x-axis represents the one spatial dimension we have, and the t-axis represents time. The line is moved upward because it represents the final state of the growth at some arbitrary time. And if we trace the growth of this line backward in time, and connect the leftmost and the rightmost endpoints along every single time step before this final state, we'll get this V shape. So this V shape represents nucleation and growth in 1D space-time, meaning one spatial dimension plus one time dimension. To clarify, that 1D before the word space-time is referring to the number of spatial dimensions. Of course, we're seeing this 1D space-time in 2D because in addition to that one spatial dimension, we need another dimension to visualize time. Some of you may be wondering what happens when we add another spatial dimension. And let's call that additional spatial dimension the y-axis. Because we still assume constant and isotropic growth, now the nucleus is growing in circles instead of lines. And if we connect the circumference of those circles, we get a cone, and hence the name time cone. So in summary, if we visualize time as an axis, we get a V-shape in 1D space-time and a cone in 2D space-time. We're not going to 3D space-time at the moment because that is a four-dimensional space which we cannot visualize, but we'll talk more about that later on. Now that we know what the time cone is, let's talk about how to use the time cone. Here we have a 1D space-time, and let's pick an arbitrary point at x and t. We want to know whether or not this point has undergone phase transformation. Suppose we put the time cone here, and we can see that this point falls within the time cone, meaning that this point has been transformed. But if we shift the time cone to the left or to the right, this point falls outside the time cone, meaning that there hasn't been any phase transformation at this point. But as soon as this point touches the boundary of the time cone, it becomes transformed. To reiterate, if a point falls within the boundary of the time cone, it has been transformed. However, if it falls outside the time cone, it remains untransformed. Next, let's plot a series of time cones. And the key insight is, not all the time cones here will lead to a phase transformation at this point in space-time. Only these three time cones highlighted in yellow will lead to a phase transformation, because this point falls within the boundaries of these three time cones. To be more precise, only the time cones that are inside this blue dotted triangle will lead to a phase transformation at this point in space-time. And to really drive home this idea, let's replace all of these with just one time cone, and let's move it around inside this blue triangle region. We can see that this white dot always remains inside the moving time cone, as long as the time cone itself is within this blue triangle. And you can easily imagine that once the time cones move outside this blue triangle region, that white dot in space-time will fall outside the time cone. As a result, we have proven that only the time cones that are within this blue triangle region will lead to a phase transformation at that dot in space-time. So in summary, what we have shown is that with concurrent nucleation and growth, there are two possible ways that a point at a given position and time will be transformed. The first is that the position of this point is the origin of a nucleation event, and this nucleation event can take place at this exact moment or at an earlier time. The second possibility is that this point is not the origin of a nucleation event, but a prior nucleation event that takes place somewhere else has grown to this position at this exact moment or at an earlier time. And the takeaway message is that for this point to be transformed, there should be at least one nucleation event or time cone present in the blue triangle region. Conversely, for this point to be untransformed, there should be no nucleation event or time cone present in this blue triangle region. Please feel free to pause here and convince yourself that this statement is correct, because it is very important for the subsequent derivation. Now let's connect the time cone to the phase fraction transformed. First of all, at any given time, the phase fraction transformed should be equal to 1 minus the phase fraction untransformed, and the phase fraction untransformed is equal to the probability that no phase transformation has occurred. Some of you may say, hold on a second, how can you equate a probability to an overall phase fraction? Well, to answer that question, let's suppose we have a 2D space. We're sampling this space with a 10 by 10 grid, and each square within this grid represents a single point in space. For every single square point in this grid, let's say the probability that it will remain untransformed is 0.2. As a result, the probability that each point will become transformed is 0.8. To visualize this transformation process, for each square, if it becomes transformed, we'll populate it with a circle. If it remains untransformed, we'll leave a blank. And let's simulate this phase transformation process with a random number generator, which will output a 10 by 10 array of numbers in the range from 0 to 1. For each number, if it is greater than or equal to 0.2, we'll say a phase transformation has occurred. If it is less than 0.2, we'll say a phase transformation has not occurred. If we replace the numbers that are greater than or equal to 0.2 with circles and count them, we should get about 80 circles. As you can see, the number here is 81, which is not exactly 80, and this is a result of the probabilistic nature of this simulation. The next part is just fun to visualize. So instead of counting the number of circles, let's simulate the effect of gravity, and let the circles fall downward to fill the void. And they should fill up to about this 80% line here. So in a nutshell, if all the points have the same 20% chance that there will be no phase transformation, then with this simulation, we can see that the overall phase fraction untransformed is also 20%. Now that we have seen how we can equate the probability that no phase transformation has occurred with the phase fraction untransformed, we can say that the phase fraction transformed is 1 minus the probability that no phase transformation has occurred. So the next step is to see how we can calculate this probability from the time cone. First of all, we make the assumption that the nucleation events are random and independent. Although this assumption may be flawed, it allows us to use the Poisson distribution. And this equation tells us the probability density function for the number of nucleation events. So k here represents the number of nucleation events. And because we said that for a given point in space-time, if there is no phase transformation at that point, it means that there is no time cone or no nucleation event inside the corresponding blue triangle region. So let's set k equal to 0. And as a result, we can express the probability that there is zero nucleation event as e to the power minus lambda. And this parameter lambda is the expected value of the random variable x. In our context, we're treating the nucleation event as its random variable. So lambda is just the expected number of nucleation events. And let's swap the symbol x for n just so that it is clear that we're talking about the nucleation events. Next, this number of nucleation events can be expressed as a product of three variables, which are the number of nucleation events per unit volume per unit time, times unit volume times unit time. And if you look at the first term here, you will find that it is just the nucleation rate J, and we can use V and T to represent unit volume and unit time. So right now we have the expected number of nucleation events as JVT. And if we group V and T together and call it omega n, we'll find that it is a spatial volume times time. And if that sounds familiar, it is because we have been talking about the time cone in some 1D and 2D space-time. If you go back to the 1D space-time case, this omega n is just the area for this blue-shaded triangle region, because remember that if we place a nucleation event or a time cone within this blue triangle region, that white dot in space-time will become transformed. If there is no nucleation or time cone in this blue triangle region, then this point in space-time will be untransformed. Let's call omega n the nucleation volume, and the only thing left to do is to calculate this nucleation volume in 1D, 2D, and 3D space-time. Starting with a 1D space-time, if the height of this blue triangle is t, and we have a growth rate r dot, then the distance traveled is r dot times t, which is also 1/2 of the base. To calculate the area, we just use a formula to calculate the area of a triangle, which is 1/2 times the base times the height. And the nucleation volume in 1D space-time is therefore r dot t squared. Then, going to the 2D space-time, this triangle becomes a cone. And again, using the formula for the volume of a cone, which is 1/3 times the area of the base times the height, the nucleation volume in 2D space-time is then pi over 3 times r dot squared times t to the power of 3. So far, we haven't talked about the 3D space-time, because we cannot visualize it. But that doesn't mean we cannot calculate it. If you look at the 2D space-time, and think about how we derive the formula for the volume of a cone, we're essentially taking slices along the time axis, and each slice is a circle. To get the volume, we just integrate the area of these circles along time. Similarly, for a 3D space-time, you can imagine that these circles now become spheres, and we can just integrate the volume of these spheres along time to get the nucleation volume in this 3D space-time. As a result, we get pi over 3 times r dot cubed times t to the power of 4. Now we have all the information needed to complete the derivation for the JMAK equation and express the phase fraction transformed as a function of time. So just to remind you, we were saying that the phase fraction transformed is equal to 1 minus the phase fraction untransformed, and the phase fraction untransformed is equal to the probability that no phase transformation has occurred. And we can express this probability as e to the power of minus the nucleation rate times the nucleation volume. Finally, let's plug in the three equations we derived with the time cone method for the nucleation volume. And voila, we can see that the phase fraction transformed for the 1D space-time is 1 minus e to the power of minus j times r dot times t squared. For the 2D space-time, it is 1 minus e to the power of minus pi over 3 times j times r dot squared times t cubed. For the 3D space-time, it is 1 minus e to the power of minus pi over 3 times j times r dot cubed times t to the power of 4. And as promised, this last equation for the 3D space-time is the JMAK equation. And the last thing I want to do is to once again plot this JMAK equation and see what happens when we change the values for the growth and nucleation rates. So as we increase the growth rate while holding the nucleation rate constant, we can see that the time it takes to reach almost 100% transformed is decreasing, which makes sense because as the nucleating phase is growing faster after they nucleate, it will take less time to complete the transformation process. Then let's hold the growth rate constant and decrease the nucleation rate. As a result, the time it takes to reach almost 100% transformed is increasing, since with fewer nuclei, it will take more time for the nucleating phase to grow to completion. We can see that with this analytical expression, we can gain physical insight very easily just by plugging some numbers and investigating how the output changes when we change the inputs. So, this is the end of my presentation. I hope you enjoyed it and learned something new. And thank you for watching.